mentioned one stock, TFCI, after the clarification that came in from the management that Cox & Kings has been making payments and, you know, there's no issue there. TFCI has recovered a tad bit. In fact, it's now up almost about 4%.
Okay, for now, the market is now trying to bounce back a bit. So perhaps that initial profit taking happened and now let us see how things pan out. The Bank Nifty is back into the green, helped mainly by Axis Bank and also IndusInd Bank. So that's looking up a bit now. Gentlemen, thanks a lot for taking us through market opening. We'll keep coming back to you. For now, we have Nilesh Shah now joining us, Managing Director of Kotak Mahindra Asset Management. Nilesh, hi, good morning. Thanks a lot for joining us. So, what's the realistic view right now? Not the optimistic or pessimistic view, since you always say that, you should have realistic view. That this market has been so bipolar and it's only, become more bipolar. This morning we presented some stats about 6 or 7 stocks accounting for half of the index.
The surprising part, Anuj, is that this is the trend globally. The super large caps above $100 billion market caps have delivered bulk of the return, and the small and mini caps below $5 billion market cap globally have given negative return. Our case is no different. Super large caps are looking expensive. Large caps are fairly valued. Small and mid caps have corrected significantly. I think there are a couple of factors which will drive the market. RBI has now started maintaining positive liquidity, which is very good, and they have assured accommodative stance. They have started cutting interest rates, and in accommodative stance, there is scope for more interest rate cuts to happen. The transmission of credit is an issue, and post-budget we'll know whether RBI's reserves are getting transferred into PSU banks, and if that happens, the credit cycle can revive. So stage is being set in terms of higher liquidity, lower interest rates, and transmission of credit. There are two variables on which we don't have control, but for whatever reason, market has believed that both those variables will be positive. One is oil, second is monsoon. The June monsoon deficit has not deterred the market. It is expecting July and August monsoon to be normal. A good monsoon is positive for rural consumption as well as rural economy. Despite everyday headlines about US and Iran skirmishes, oil prices have remained reasonably stable, and market is pricing in that oil prices will continue to remain stable within the current range. So subject to oil and monsoon, I think market is trying to make a bottom in small and mid-cap stocks. The super large caps may not move, but the small and mid caps could start moving up if oil and monsoon supports.
Good morning, Nilesh. Good to have you with us. Do you think the market is going into the budget with a lot of long positions? Is there a chance of any sell-off thereafter? Or is it the other way around? It's going in with very little expectations, and therefore there is unlikely to be any sell-off. If anything, it can continue to be healthy after the budget.
So market, I'll give you a slightly diplomatic answer. Market is having a prayer, but not the hope. The expenses side of the budget is already committed. Pension, salary, interest, defense, and subsidies. The budget really does not have scope on the expenditure side. The vote on account also announced certain welfare schemes and subsidies. So effectively, your expenditure side is pretty committed. The prayer in the market is that finance minister will do some magic on the revenue side to create some capital expenditure. The private investment has not picked up. It's not looking like that it will pick up in near future, and hence the government will have to carry the heavy load. In vote on account, you could not have announced capital expenditure, but in budget there is a prayer that government will carry the heavy load like Virat Kohli or Rohit Sharma and do the heavy lifting. On the other side, on the taxation side, you have again limited choices. You can't change India's nature of becoming tax compliant overnight. It's a gradual process. So there are two choices. Either you raise debt or you raise equity. We have brought down interest rates despite fiscal concern. Now, if we exceed fiscal concern, then certainly interest rates will go up. So if you are pursuing the debt path, then you have to create a new demand for debt, for example, by getting included into emerging market bond index. China with $3 trillion reserve has become part of EMBI. We at $426 billion of reserve should seriously consider that. On the other hand, if we don't pursue the path of debt and we pursue the path of equity, then you have to go strategic divestment route. Mm. 20 years back, we divested Hindustan Zinc. It was producing 100,000 tons at that point of time. Today it makes 1 million ton, 10 times more. At that point of time, it was receiving support from the government. In these 2 decades, it has given 1,60,000 crore to the government by way of dividend and taxes. Mm. The price at which 51% of Hindustan Zinc was sold, today 25% holding of government in that company is far more valuable, and the dividend income is more than the price at which it was sold. So can we pursue the path of strategic divestment whereby support from the government or support from the budget stops and income in the budget starts over the next couple of years? Mm. If we can do something like this, which is path breaking, it will be a dream budget for the market. Market is certainly praying for this kind of out of box thinking, but I don't think so it is hoping for that.
You know, actually, Nilesh, hi, good morning. This is Sonia here. You're the second person in the last 1 hour who's told us that if there is any plan on strategic divestment, then the market will take it very positively. I guess that's the big thing on the market's mind. But by the way, there's been a pickup in the market as well. So this buy on dip strategy continues, and it's the banks that are batting for the bulls this morning. So it's a 100-point rally on the Bank Nifty right now, led by Yes Bank, IndusInd Bank, Axis Bank, the whole lot. That's looking pretty good at the moment. But Nilesh, in the near term, do you think the valuation headroom for the Nifty looks limited in an environment of earnings downgrades? I mean, you know, this is still a market that's trading at about 19 times FY20.
The optical growth in earnings will be reasonably solid. Couple of corporate focused private as well as public sector banks will show significant jump in the profit. Pharma companies also will show reasonable growth in profit. Telecom sector at some point of time looks like that they are bottoming out in terms of price competition, and their losses could reduce, thereby adding to the delta positively. So optically, I think Nifty earnings growth will look far superior in FY20 vis-a-vis FY19 or FY18. What is more critical is the valuation at the small and mid-cap level, where we think there is a significant correction. I quote a tweet from a friend. The B group market cap in November-December 2016 was 9 lakh crore, and last week also it was 9 lakh crore. Obviously, between 2019 to 2016, these companies have grown, but the market cap hasn't reflected that. So Nifty probably will remain in a range-bound fashion, but the real return from the markets will be made in small and mid-cap portfolios.
Hey, by the way, the market is now up. After that initial profit taking from yesterday, the market's bouncing back. IndusInd Bank really is your star of the Bank Nifty now. Now that Bharat Financial is no longer there, that one's, you know, the move started at 3 p.m. yesterday. And from that, it's picked up a bit and now looking up quite a bit right now, in fact. Nilesh, for the small retail investors, you know, while this presents a very nice anecdote and, you know, very nice fact, it does not reflect too well on their portfolios. That is the problem point. You know, buying HDFC Bank, Kotak, all this has worked, but buying value has not worked. You reckon that will change at some point then, if that is where the money is to be made, because you know, it's not worked for last 2 years. That's the limited point.
Undoubtedly, Anuj, in India, unlocking value is very, very difficult. Clearly, in our case, it is growth at reasonable price which works rather than value. There's no point in buying a company which has huge set of assets, because you never know whether the promoter is going to encash it or not. And even if he encashes, will it be shared with the minority shareholders or not? So my focus will be buying in small and mid-cap stock portfolios, companies which have lower leverage, whose working capital cycle is not stretched, and who has a reasonable track record of dealing with minority shareholders in a fair manner. I think in an environment where banking liquidity is improving, interest rates have come down, and there is better transmission of credit expected post-budget, in this scenario, small and mid-caps will do well. Clearly, government will do heavy lifting for improving growth prospects of the economy. And on the side, if oil and monsoon supports, we could see growth at reasonable price working well in small and mid-cap portfolios.
Okay, actually, there's a big bond rally happening across the world and actually in India as well. Today, 6.8, Nilesh, on the 10-year. What's your guess, since you know more rate cuts are lined up, given the way in which inflation and crude prices are panning out? What's your guess on the 10-year? Is it 6.5 or is it much lower that you can see in 2019?
If budget announces a roadmap for getting into emerging market bond index, I think the journey is below 6%, because there will be $75 to $100 billion demand for government securities. On the other hand, if we choose the path of borrowing money from the debt market to fund our fiscal deficit, and we have a loosening of fiscal discipline, then the downside on the yield will be limited, because then markets will be always worried about the supply and RBI's OMO policy.
Since we are talking about the budget expectations, I just have one final question, Nilesh, before we move on. In fact, we do have the National Highway Authority of India, representative who will be joining us in a bit as well. So I want to lead into that by asking you about your expectations for the infrastructure space, because, you know, there is an expectation that there could be issuances of infrastructure bonds through an SPV route, etc., in order to fund this additional public capex, basically methods to spur growth. In that context, are you still optimistic on some of these players like L&T, etc.? I mean, there's been a big surge up until now, but do you see more money to be made here in the capital goods space?
So there are a couple of things on infrastructure side, and let me come bottom up rather than top down. I had a friend who was a government contractor. He was supposed to receive monthly payment from government. The payment got delayed. He put his personal capital into business to service bank loans. One day he couldn't do it. His bank loan, he defaulted by one day. He was classified as SMA1. His letter of credit facility was withdrawn, and he was supposed to lift material from sale by providing LC. That didn't work out, and then he couldn't finish his contract. Now there is a payment delay by government authority, yet this entrepreneur is suffering. Such kind of suffering has to stop if you believe contractors have to work in India. The second thing is related to rights of debenture holders. We have invested in debentures where the repayment is secured through the escrow mechanism. And when a company goes into moratorium and those escrow mechanisms don't work, while our monies remain in the bank account and we are hopeful that it will be paid back to us over a period of time, but in the near term, because there is default in payment of interest, they are downgraded as D. We have to provide 75% of the face value. Such behavior in capital market is not acceptable. So you have to first put your house in order on bottom-up basis. Ensure that payments are made to people on time, because they have to make payment on time to bankers. Ensure that contractual obligations are honored, especially for secured lenders like mutual funds and other investors. The rights and obligations of lenders have to be honored. It can't be taken for granted.
We saw your photograph with the Prime Minister, Nilesh. You were there when all the prominent people were asked for advice. Did you tell the Prime Minister that most of the PSUs and authorities are listed on the treads so that they honor their payments? That clearly is everybody's problem. Government doesn't pay on time.
I think the entire summation was summed up very nicely by Mr. N. Chandra of Tata Sons. He said that we have to choose between growth, fiscal and inflation, and growth is the solution for India's most of the problem. Second, if you want to pursue the path of growth, we have to provide capital, both debt and equity, If your NBFCs are not lending, if your PSU banks are not lending, and only few private sector banks are doing heavy lifting, the growth is never going to happen. Third, there is a risk aversion today. Risk aversion is due to various things. You have to accept genuine failure. If there is a malafide intention, definitely go after it. No one is saying that we have to pardon criminals, but at the same time, we have to accept that in businesses, genuine failure will occur, and we have to live with it. I think that was the beautiful summation for the situation which India is facing today, and I am equally hopeful that Prime Minister and his team will do the necessary.
All right. Nilesh Shah, it was a pleasure speaking with you. Thank you very much indeed for joining us, and let's hope we are going to touch base on Budget Day itself.